Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Good morning across the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. I'm Todd Albaugh. It is Tuesday, April 18th, 2023. Welcome into hour number three here on the show this morning. Some tranquility, some common sense, some groundedness has entered the program, which all the listeners say, thank God. Luke Mathers, co-host of Dueling Tangents.
Oh, you're talking about me?
Yes.
Oh.
You. You, Lukester.
Stop it.
Luke is joining us a little bit early. He's a busy dude. He has all kinds of responsibilities, but still kind enough to make time for us. We appreciate you.
I realized yesterday that I blindly accepted a 10:30 phone call, and I was like, oh, yeah, I don't think I have anything going on at that time. And then this morning, I looked, and I was like, wait. Now I got to feel like an ass and ask Todd, is it okay if I join you half an hour early? And you were so gracious.
Well, you're gracious with your time, and we always appreciate you whatever time you have. So thanks for stopping. How is your morning going, Luke?
It's going pretty good. We got a lot going on around the different facilities, and there's so much going on. It is like hard to truly picture sometimes the vastness of the endeavor that we're undertaking. But here on a gorgeous Tuesday morning in April, we're having a lot of fun and excited for the busy day ahead.
Yeah, a beautiful day here at the World Headquarters in Madison. Yeah. Blue skies and nice spring temperatures across the state of Wisconsin. WRCE. News from the center in southwest Wisconsin. Weather forecast for today. Sunny skies, a high near 51 degrees. Tonight, mostly clear. A chance of showers towards morning. A low of 32. And then for tomorrow, Wednesday, showers likely. 70% chance and a high tomorrow of 56 degrees in the RC. Moving up to the center part of the state, Wausau, WXCO, Bull Falls Radio. Be aware there are still some flood warnings due to melting snow and some additional rain and whatnot, particularly the low-lying areas along the Wisconsin River. Was some concern for the homeless population that may be encampment along that area. But if you are going to be in a low-lying area around Wausau, just be aware there are flood warnings around that area. Otherwise, sunny skies today, a high near 48 degrees, mostly clear then tonight at a low of 26. Tomorrow, a wintry mix, 80% chance. A high of 41 degrees. The nice thing you can do is set out your margarita glass and get that wintry mix in there. Add vodka and you're set. So I mean, that's fantastic.
Vodka and your margarita glass?
Well,
come on.
Or whatever, tequila, whatever you want.
Okay. Spirit of choice.
The spirit of choice. I was a terrible bartender, by the way. Over at Amory, WLAK, Lake Air Radio Land. Sunny skies today. A high near 40 degrees. And then for tonight, make that 49 degrees, pardon me. And then for tonight, partly cloudy skies, a chance of showers, breezy conditions, a low near 31. And in Amory tomorrow, a wintry mix as well, breezy, freezing rain and showers, a high near 44 degrees. Not the greatest day tomorrow over in Amory. So get out and enjoy the warm weather today. Mr. Mathers, what do you have coming up on Dueling Tangents later on today?
Oh, we got a ton of things to talk about going on here in Wisconsin right now. The legislature is in session today, so I can't wait to talk about that. That's going to be a fun one. Because
what sort of gross incompetence will they be up to today?
It does make news when they actually decide to do some work, because for far too often as of late, they kind of sit around with their feet up. So we're going to actually look at some of the legislative proposals before the state legislature today. I got a number of headlines I want to get to, hoping that Dan Schaefer, now that he's back from vacation, we'll be able to join us on a Tuesday afternoon. But got to check in with him just to make sure that his schedule allows. It should be a great Tuesday across the Civic Media Network on Dueling Tangents.
But looking forward to it at 2 o'clock with Luke and Brian, of course, across the entire Civic Media Network, except in Bull Falls Radio, WXTO Wausau, where Chad Holmes has the Chad Holmes Show from 2 until 4. But across the rest of the network, it is the Luke Mathers Kingdom.
No, let's not refer. That's not accurate. There's a hole in the lineup, and I fill it for an hour. Essentially,
no, come on, now.
It's a nice little space gap. But Matt Flynn following me 3-4. He did a terrific job filling in for the Devil's Advocates yesterday. We got Matt Rothschild, executive director of the Wisconsin Democracy Campaign, filling in for Crudy and Dom this afternoon as well. So some great fill-in Devils, guest Devils. I believe you did a little shift last week.
I was a guest Devil last week, and you were so kind as to invite me to be a tangent yesterday.
Yeah, well, it could have been last Wednesday because you were so booked going on everybody else's show. But yes, it was a great hour yesterday. We had a terrific conversation about where you get your information. I think it's a very important conversation to continue to be having these days because part of what we're doing here at Civic Media is we want to be a place where Wisconsinites can tune in for news, sports, entertainment, and the talk that we provide as a radio network as well. But we want to be a hub of information for Wisconsinites.
Absolutely. Information galore. Here's the question I like to ask. And I like some conservative people to call it. I'd be fantastic. Are you prepared to get rid of all your Disney movies? Will you let your kids no longer watch Disney? I'm talking about anything with the princesses. I'm talking about the Disney Channel. I'm talking about the Donald Duck and the Mickey Mouse stuffed animals. Are you prepared to clean your house of Disney? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. Because come on now. If you're a conservative, if you're a Republican, you shot up your Bud Light. You did your part with Kid Rock. But are you ready to get rid of your Disney? Come on now. You can't be a Republican no more if you got Disney in the house. Come on back. We'll explain after this. This is the Todd Allbowl Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network with the great Luke Mather. The Todd Allbowl Show is now at 10:15 on the Civic Media Radio Network. Being joined this half hour by our good friend Luke Mathers, co-host of Dueling Tangents on Civic Media at 3 o'clock each, or pardon me, 2 o'clock each and every afternoon across the Civic Media Radio Network, with the exception of WXCO in Wausau. Glad to have Luke with us. Luke, we're talking about this story, and for those that don't, I'll quickly give the quick background. So so there was the DeSantis Don't Say Gay bill, where he attacked teachers and didn't want teachers and elementary kids talking about using the word gay or having a kid say, well, I have questions or things like that. You can't.
Notoriously, Todd, if you say gay, it can mean that you could become gay.
Well, look what happened to me. I mean, it was one Disney movie and it was all over. And it was spandex and sequins after that.
The nonsensical argument of, oh, this is not for... And they use the arguments for the Don't Say Gay bill that they pushed through the Florida state government that, oh, well, we're just talking about young elementary school children. We're just talking about up to third grade, kindergarten through third grade. And then immediately, because of the way they wrote the bill, the way that it was written, they expanded it all the way up to K through 12.
Right.
And so it's not just that they're insincere in their arguments, that they're nonsensical in their arguments. It's just there's a totalitarian mindset that they're like, if we pass this legislation, we can do whatever we want and this will solve our problems. And it's not. It's not even a problem to solve. It's stupid. And Ron DeSantis is picking these stupid political fights for the hope that one day it's going to make him president. And I don't think he's got a really good shot at it.
And for those who might be listening, my previous comment was completely tongue-in-cheek.
Yes.
All right, my sexual orientation has nothing to do with the way I was raised. Or any, as Lady Gaga says, I love the song, I was born that way. So let's just put that out there first and foremost. But so DeSantis, when he becomes governor, he misses Don't Say Gay bill. Disney, after their old CEO, Chipek, whatever his name was, didn't really come out strongly against that. But then Bob Iger, the old CEO, is now back at Disney, and they're like, well, we're not going to stand for this.
Yeah.
And they came out pretty strongly against this. Well, DeSantis didn't like it. And again, quickly, not to get too deep in the weeds, Walt Disney, the mastermind that he was, when he picked this swamp in the middle of Florida to create his entire empire, he was smart enough, had the vision to say, someday this is going to be something, and I want complete control over it. So legally, completely legally, he set up essentially a district, mm-hmm. a legal district, whereby Disney basically gets to approve their own building permits, their own infrastructure. They control, for all intents and purposes, the land on which they have their business.
Yeah, the plot of land in Orlando and that area is self-governing.
Right.
By Disney.
By Disney. By law. Completely yes. legal. So DeSantis gets a hair up his burr, and he says, hey, we're gonna create, I'm going to work with my colleagues, the Republicans in the legislature, and we're going to take all that away from Disney. Mm-hmm. We're going to put it under Florida control. Well, the Disney folks didn't say too much. And quietly, the day before this happened in the legislature, Disney, it was all done in the light of day with proper noticing, all according to legalities. They changed the structure of the district and basically said, yeah, we're not going to allow the board to have the power. We're actually going to put that back with Disney Corporation.
Yep.
And took all the power away from this district. And so when DeSantis' guys got there a couple days later, his appointees, they're like, well, you can't do this. You can't change the rules. And it was all done legally, and it was beautiful. So today in New York Magazine, a new story here by, let me get the author's name here, Jonathan Chait, says, last year, Florida's Governor Ron DeSantis retaliated against the Walt Disney Company for criticizing his ban on gender instruction in the state. A law DeSantis has advertised as merely restricting sexualized instruction, but in fact, it is driving the state schools to target depictions of gay relationships. Disney boldly refused to knuckle under. 2 weeks ago, CEO Bob Iger denounced DeSantis for retaliating against his company. Disney announced it was neutering the powers of the board DeSantis planned to bring to the firm on heel. On Monday yesterday, DeSantis lashed out again. He announced a series of new, even more thuggish legislative threats against Disney. He's doing this to send a message to both every private business and his party that his performative dominion of Disney is a model for how he plans to campaign and, if successful, to govern. He is establishing the norm that criticizing Ron DeSantis is dangerous for business. Luke, this is authoritarianism 101. And we can laugh about it if you want and say, well, this is a Disney thing, whatever. This, remember, if someone reveals to you who they are, believe them.
Yeah.
This he's trying to out-authoritarian Trump.
Yeah, he's got to go to the right on him, and DeSantis has to go to the right of Trump if he wants to win a Republican primary, which is, I think, what his goal is. He hasn't yet announced. They're still in the middle of the budget session down there in Florida. He's got to, sign in the middle of the night 6-week abortion bans and not respond to Fort Lauderdale being underwater while campaigning in Ohio. Those are the priorities that Ron DeSantis has. But a lot of the other priorities are trying to go to the right of Donald Trump. And there's not a whole lot of room to the right of a man that fomented a coup against our nation. Like, you got to go pretty authoritarian
pretty
if
far.
You want to go to the right of Donald Trump on some of these issues. And so, yeah, Ron DeSantis is signaling a lot of how he's going to sign legislation in the middle of the night. He's going to go to the right and try to take unilateral control of governing boards. And it's just all to signal that he wants to be president. And I don't know. There's going to be a lot of debates like this over the next 18 months as we go into the 2024 cycle. And the more that I learn about Ron DeSantis, the less I think he's got the chops to actually do this. And I think it's really performative. And that's scary, though.
Yeah.
It is scary because the sense of how performative it is indicates that he's willing to go to whatever extreme he believes will get him the nomination of the Republican Party in 2024. And we've been on a downward spiral since 2016, really, of seeing how far some candidates will go to try to win that nomination.
To me, it's scary because, again, this isn't done out of, I'm a representative of the people. I'm here to help folks. And we're talking about this in Wisconsin as well. with education or even guns. I said, show me, as a former Republican, show me one Republican, just one, in the Assembly and the State Senate today in Wisconsin who will stand up and say, you know what, we should at least entertain some sort of reasonable gun reform in Wisconsin. Not a ban, just reasonable reform. Show me one Republican today, Assembly or Senate, that would look at this story today about DeSantis and say, that's going too far. That's just a nut job. We won't find it.
No, especially you won't find it among anybody that has ambitions to have higher political office either. So not only will you not see that in the people that are currently in those positions of power, anybody that wants to run for a higher position of power is going to avoid stances like that as well, Todd, because they have to go through a Republican primary to then get to those positions of higher power, and they can't win a Republican primary if they go out on a limb and take any of those stances on any of those number of issues that you just referenced.
You probably saw that. We haven't gotten to it today, but our old friend, tongue-in-cheek, Tom Tiffany, the leader that he is, Tom Tiffany.
Buying up some domains.
Buying the domains for U.S. Senate run. He thinks he is U.S. Senate material, and he is a whack job with a capital W. I mean, I had the displeasure of getting to know him a little bit in the state Senate. He guy's cuckoo brain. He's Fruit Loops.
He already has a pretty interesting nickname from what I've heard as well, of Toxic Tom Tiffany. And I feel like if he tries to run for U.S. Senate here, we're going to hear that three-word alliteration a lot. Those are going to be a lot of T's coming up.
But to your point, he is a right-wing MAGA guy.
And he's somebody that could win a statewide primary in Wisconsin, but I don't think he fares very well unless all of a sudden the Republicans are like, well, we really, 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 really want to beat Tammy Baldwin, and we're going to write whatever size check we need to write. Because unfortunately, in states like Wisconsin and the states that it requires for an electoral college victory, when you talk about the presidential campaigns, there are so few votes that decide those margins in those states that outside spending can make all the difference in that. And so I firmly believe that Tammy Baldwin is going to be the largest vote getter come 2024 in the state of Wisconsin, including among those presidential candidates. But that's not saying that these right-wing billionaires are going to come in and spend as much as they need to possibly get Tom Tiffany or any other far-right candidate that the Republicans would put up and would be viable to win a statewide primary to write those checks and just have the money flowing in like we saw last month or earlier this month. Jeez, it's still only April.
I know, right? Only April. Only April so far.
The false summer last week really is throwing me off, Todd. I don't know about you.
I had a nice July 4th back at it here. Nice to be back. You've had our friend Matt Rothschild from Wisconsin Democracy on campaign on your show. I've had him on this show, been on Pat Kreitler's show and others. You know, here's a guy who keeps track of the money.
Mm-hmm.
And you brought up the whole money of these billionaires. I mean, you got Dick Uihlein across the border. And it's time to nip Dick Uihlein a little bit. And because we can't keep having his money. You understand? We can't keep having this money flow. But the laws don't allow us to do it. Citizens United.
Yeah, there's been a lot of relaxing of the rules. And I think a renewal, that's where this kind of needs to go next, Todd, is we're having conversations about defending democracy against coups, against insurrections, against things like that. But we also need to talk about not just defending democracy. We need to strengthen democracy. And I think being able to do things like cleaning up money and having people at least disclose. Fine, if you want to say how much money you could have unlimited, but if you could get at least disclosure first, that would be the first step in knowing of who's spending what where. I think there's a large area for that to be picked up when it comes to judicial ethics as well. There was a lot of conservatives pretty upset about that here in Wisconsin. Let's have that conversation. Let's talk about what requirements we want to see of our judges here in Wisconsin and on the U.S. Supreme Court. Because Clarence Thomas, I think, needs to answer some questions.
That'd be nice. That'd be great.
It would be really great. And so talking about strengthening democracy and having these conversations, again, it gets back to a lot of the core of where you get your information and what we're trying to do here at Civic Media to be able to provide the news and the what's going on in the world and not, you know, potentially get sued by Dominion voting machines because we were spouting lies about them.
I'm a little hot this morning, I'll admit that. But I'm tired of people like Jay Rothman lying to people in the state of Wisconsin, particularly Richland Center, over our education. I'm tired of 16-year-old black kids getting shot by 84-year-old white dudes just because they went to the wrong house. It gets me a little hot. And as our caller last hour, Jeff Perry, said, what can we do? I said, we could vote. We could do what we did last Tuesday. We could all get off our posteriors and go vote. Because, Luke, that's the only thing that's going to change it.
Voting and having these conversations with the people in our lives to say, hey, where are you getting your news? Where are you getting your information? And having these conversations and trying to get back to a place where a lot of us can agree.
Didn't have time to get into it. But, Luke, what does it take for the Bucks and Six?
Two losses, folks. So, yeah, I'm not going to overreact. It sounds like Giannis may be ready to play tomorrow night. So
he is a machine.
Fingers crossed. Yeah, he is a freak. Greek freak for sure.
Luke Mathers, thanks for joining us, my friend. You can hear Luke every afternoon, 2 until 3 on the Civic Media Radio Network on Dueling Tangents with Brian Kelly.
Thanks,
Todd. Back with more after this. This is the Tom Walsh Show on Civic Media.
The cold never bothered me anyway.
On the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to have you along with us on a Tuesday morning. Talking this hour, we appreciate Luke Mathers, by the way, stopping in as well. Chatting a little bit with us this morning. Always great to see Luke. And again, you can hear him every afternoon from 2 until 3 on the Civic Media Radio Network with his partner in crime. That is the wonderful Brian Kelly on Dueling Tangents. Everywhere except Bull Falls Radio, WXCO, where from 2 until 4, you can hear the great Chad Holmes. And the great Chad Holmes Show. Great lineups here on Civic Media. Back to this story on Ron DeSantis now going to war with the Walt Disney Company. Want to hear what you think? 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. If you're a Republican, if you're a conservative, are you ready to get rid of all the Disney stuff in your house? Take away your kids' Disney movies. Get rid of the princess movies, the costumes, the toys. Anything Disney at all, you got to get rid of if you're a real Republican. I mean, they're shooting up Bud Light. Republicans are against Bud Light now. Got to be against Disney, right? For those who don't know what I'm talking about, it was a... The Bud Light Anheuser-Busch did a promotional thing with a transgender person promoting Bud Light, the transgender community. Companies do this all the time. They find nuanced areas. Could be women, could be men, could be hunters, could be gay people, could be straight people, could be certain ethnicities. So Bud Light went with to promote the beer. I think it was a TikTok account with a transgender person. Oh, my gosh, you would have thought that the house was burning down. The right-wing Republicans went nutso. Kid Rock out shooting up cases of Bud Light.
With tears streaming down his face.
Yes, because this is going to... They started calling it the trans beer. Not joking. Until finally the Republican National Committee, Republican National Congressional Committee, the fundraising arm for people like Derek Van Orten in Congress said, well, you know, maybe we shouldn't pick on Anheuser-Busch because it turns out they're one of our largest donors. Even Don Trumpster Jr. got in on it. The Trumpster Jr. saying, quit the boycott of Bud Light. Just quit that, please. I think he was also, I was a bad impersonation of Don Jr. It was more like, He keeps certain lines off the bathroom mirrors. And he says, don't do that, Don Jr. says. Don't do a boycott of Anheuser-Busch. We need that money. But they went crazy. The conservatives did, the Republicans, over Bud Light. So I can't imagine what they're going to do now. I mean, if you have a Donald Trump 2024 sign up, if you have a Ron DeSantis sign, if you have a Derek Van Orten sign, you better not have a Disney princess inside. I mean, you better not have any Disney memorabilia. You better not have a Disney movie if you're a real Trumpster, if you're a real mega. 715-388-7155. Again, area code 715-388-7155. By the way, before I get into this rest of the story real quick, an update. The FAA issued a nationwide ground stop for Southwest Airlines about a half an hour ago due to equipment issues. It was the entire airline of Southwest. And apparently now, just breaking, it's been lifted. So I have no idea whether it was a computer issue or what. The key thing is, if you are flying somewhere today on Southwest, you may want to check in or call ahead. Maybe some delays. But Southwest Airlines now resuming flights after a nationwide grounding or stopping earlier this morning. Back to this story in New York Magazine. So DeSantis is making these threats. Governor Ron DeSantis of Florida, because he's ticked off that Disney out-policied him, out-politicked him, and did an end runaround and got this district that Disney has most of their property on, a self-governing. And DeSantis is ticked off. Article says the threats the governor floated were almost cartoonishly disconnected from one another or any coherent principle of good governance. DeSantis warned that he may crack down on the inspection of Disney theme park rides, require pay increases for first responders, require its resorts to post notice warnings about human trafficking, build more affordable housing, and perhaps use land adjacent to Walt Disney World to build another amusement park or state prison. I'm not making this up. When a reporter asked DeSantis if he planned safety inspections of rides at other Florida theme parks, he replied that only Disney would be subject to such treatment. This isn't about ride safety or cracking down on human trafficking or finding more land for prisons, and it isn't even intended to be seen as such. Literally, none of this would be happening if Disney hadn't issued a statement criticizing a DeSantis-backed law. Perhaps to give him legal cover or provide political cover for a handful of Republican defenders who claim to care about the rule of law, DeSantis punctuated his threats with periodic claims that he was merely eliminating any special treatment for Disney. But he and his allies repeatedly gave the game away. Quote, "You are in business of entertaining children and families. You are not in the business of social re-engineering or promoting radical political ideologies," scolded State Representative Carolina Amnesty, standing by the governor's side. Quote, "There's a larger principle at stake. It's that we are a government of laws, not a government of individual men or even a government of woke corporations based in California," DeSantis said. The principle, in other words, is that corporations are free to promote any ideology they want as long as it's congenial to DeSantis and the Republican Party. That is the relationship between business and the state that prevails in places like Hungary, Russia, and China. DeSantis is demonstrating that his bullying of Disney is not an error, nor is it a one-off? In fact, this is the DeSantis blueprint. It's exactly how he'll govern if he's president of the United States. God forbid. The author is so right that this relationship between business and the state that prevails in places like Hungary, Russia, and China have now come to Florida. And God forbid, to the White House if he's elected. And you don't believe me? I hate to even do this, but here's DeSantis talking yesterday in his own words. What he's going to do or wants to think about doing to Disney if they don't acquiesce to his social agenda.
District. you know, one of the things they tried to do was put restrictive covenants on the land that the district owns. So if you look at this whole special district, Walt Disney Corporation obviously owns a lot of it, but the district owns other land. You know, quite frankly, I wasn't even thinking about that land. This was not something that was really important one way or another. We just wanted them to live under the same rules, pay the debt, pay the taxes, all that stuff. Oh, but come to think of it, now people are like, well, there's, what should we do with this land? And so, you know, it's like, okay, kids, I mean, people have said, you know, maybe have maybe create a state park, maybe try to do more amusement parks. Someone even said, like, maybe you need another state prison. Who knows? I mean, I just think that the possibilities are endless. And so that is now going to be analyzed to see what would make the most sense and district.
There you go. Ron DeSantis in his own words. Well, y'all get it up. Maybe we'll just put a new state prison next to where you take your five-year-olds to Walt Disney World. Maybe that'd be a good thing. Y'all get it up. Author of this article in New York Magazine is 100% right. This is the stuff out of Hungary, China, and Russia. If you don't agree with the ruler, 100% of the time, he will use his powers of the state to come down on you.
It's just as childishly vindictive as Putin seems to be, too. Like, with him, he just kind of strikes at whatever he feels like a toddler. And Ron DeSantis here is like, oh, Disney made me upset. I'm going to attack Disney until they're dead in the ground. And Scott Walker is like, oh, I didn't graduate college. I'm going to attack colleges till I'm dead in the ground.
Yeah, that's a very good way to put it, Mr. Zomers. A lot of similarities between guys like Walker and DeSantis. Juvenile. Petulant. Not much else that you can make of that, quite frankly. Give us your call. Give us your opinion. 715-388-7155. Again, 715-388-7155. Would love to hear from you this morning.
I would like to add one thing. I think it's clever what Disney did. I don't necessarily think that's right. I don't like when big corporations just form monopolies or close to it and just keep building up power and create special rules for themselves. But that's how it is. And Ron DeSantis is not attacking it for the right reasons of saying, hey, this might be a little unfair. He's saying, I don't like Disney. They're mean to me.
Well, yeah, it's a good point. But I think also you have to take into context that Walt Disney went into Florida and bought a swamp that no one wanted. I mean, there was nothing there.
That is true.
A mosquito-infested, gator-infested swamp. And you can, you know, we can have arguments, or not arguments, but discussions about, you know, was it the best thing for the environment to create a city in a swamp? Should Disney have all this control? But the fact is that Disney put in probably billions now, but certainly tens or hundreds of millions of dollars into Central Florida. It is the biggest employer of Central Florida. It is a large reason why Floridians don't pay property taxes, or pardon me, income taxes, because of all the tourism there. So, you know, I don't necessarily blame Disney for being smart and setting something up. It was not Disney of the 1950s, was not Disney of 2023. But I get your point. I agree that I don't particularly like big corporations having all this control either. But it was the rules of the ground game were staked out long ago. Disney's just playing by the game.
That's true.
And to your other point, Mr. Zomers, I agree that if you're going to go to war with a major corporation like this, let it be over something that actually matters. Not some petulant, childish bullying thing of, hey, I don't like this type of person, so I'm just going to bully him and use my pulpit of governor to even make it worse on kids that happen to be trans or gay. And then they have the audacity, the mean-spiritedness to say that things like beer or Disney or whatever somehow are going to, quote unquote, make you a certain way. Make you gay. Make you trans.
Beer will make you drunk.
Yes, beer will make you drunk. But on a slightly lighter note, and this is why one of the main reasons I do love the Walt Disney Corporation. You want to know what the response to all of this has been? All this new attacks by DeSantis? A couple hours after DeSantis had that little press conference, through his fit, Walt Disney put this out. The first ever Disneyland After Dark Pride Night is coming to Disneyland during Pride Month in June. This separately ticketed event celebrating the LGBTQIA+ community and allies will have themed entertainment, Disney characters, specialty menu items, and more. Join us on Pride Night in June. Walt Disney. You gotta love him. Back with more after this. This is the Todd Allball Show, and this is the Civic Media Radio Network. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show, the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to have you along with us on this Tuesday morning, the 18th of April, 2023. Don't forget, coming up at the top of the hour, 11 o'clock, we'll have a news and weather update for you. And then at 10:06, it is another great rendition of As Goes Wisconsin with our friends Kristen Bry and Jane Matinere. As Goes Wisconsin, coming up next here across the Civic Media Radio Network. Encourage you all to stick around for the great program that it is. Kristen been off for a couple of days. I believe she is back today. I think Joseph Pecky filled in with Jane yesterday. Great show yesterday. So I believe Kristen is back in the chair today along with Jane Matinere. Another great rendition of As Goes Wisconsin just after the top of the hour. Then at 2 o'clock on Bull Falls Radio, as we've said, it is the great Chad Holmes and the Chad Holmes Show on WXCO. Bull Falls Radio, across the rest of the Civic Media Radio Network. We have our friend that was just with us, right? Luke Mathers, Brian Kelly, Dueling Tangents from 2 until 3. At 3 o'clock, Matt Flynn pulling double duty yesterday on his own show, as well as Devils. Matt Flynn will be in with Matt Flynn direct at 3. At 4 o'clock, nothing personal, only politics. It is the Devils Advocates with Crudy and Dom. Crudy is out in Vegas right now at the National Association of Broadcasters Convention. So I'm not sure who Dom is there filling in, but it'll be a great show. I'm not sure who's filling in today.
Yeah, I'm not sure either.
But we'll see. And then at 6 o'clock, it's Native Roots Radio, news from a Native American perspective. And then 8 o'clock, Rick Smith Across America. Another great lineup today. Also today, want to leave you on a couple of notes here, quick notes. One, an important one. The other one important, but also, I think, uplifting. Today marks 90 days since the U.S. Treasury reached its current debt ceiling of $31.4 trillion. That means that since January 19th, 2023, we've been using accounting gimmicks to cover our own bills, we in terms of the United States of America. After 3 months of this, Wall Street is now getting nervous. Republican House Speaker Kevin McCarthy went to Wall Street yesterday hoping to calm investors and bankers. It's doubtful his sticking to our gun speech soothed anyone. McCarthy's problem is trying to convince people our nation faces an existential spending crisis after Republicans had no problem with three votes that raised the debt limit 25% during Trump's 4 years. It also does not help to claim that President Biden has done nothing when Biden, who has laid out a budget and plan, and McCarthy has not. McCarthy appears unable to put forth a budget plan to which Republicans in the House or Senate can agree. It turns out that Senate Republicans are not keen to slash food assistance to millions of American children and low-income adults. Why? Because senators have been reelected in a statewide race, while many House members run in districts so gerrymandered that they are safe to take it to extreme positions. A U.S. default on debts would be a financial crisis, according to Mark Zandi, chief economist at Moody's Analytics, that is, to the Washington Post. Quote, our geopolitical standing in the world will be undermined, he said. McCarthy is in a hopeless situation. He brought himself to this situation by conceding to impossible demands on the most extreme mega Republican House members. So it's 90 days today on the Republican debt ceiling threat, and the question to Kevin McCarthy and the Republicans remains, where's the budget? Not where's the beef, but Kevin McCarthy, where's the budget?
Where's the beef?
That's fantastic. And finally, I want to leave you on this note. Some good news. Some good news for modern men, as they used to say. DeMar Hamlin from the Buffalo Bills, according to reports, is back at practice today. Finally back at practice. That is fantastic news. After collapsing and having the heart condition of the field last fall, he is back at practice. I'm not so sure that I'd have the courage to do that, to get back up and back on the field and go out there. But he did. And you know what? It's his life. He can live it how he leads. What do they say? You know, when you fall off a horse, the first thing you should do is get up and get back on. So I admire him for that reason. He wants to go live his life. None of us know, right? None of us know how much we have left. And so that's why if today's show sounded a little chippy, if thought I was a little hot today, I have been. And I appreciate your time letting me vent a little bit, quite frankly, to you today. But I think these are big issues. And we have to live our life as DeMar Hamlin is showing today, but getting back on the football field. We have to make each day count.
And would you be happy if you have a platform where you can, this you, as in not to you, Todd, but to this people, if you had a platform where you can talk about politics and try to advocate what you think is right, and you didn't spend time talking about not shooting kids, how would you feel about yourself?
Yeah. I mean, Luke Mather said it earlier. It's a responsibility that each one of us here at Civic Media has to use our time with you on a daily basis to make it worthwhile. Sometimes that's giving you information. Sometimes that's listening to what you have to say. Sometimes that's trying to motivate people to get out and vote and do something. Sometimes it's just to make us all smile and laugh and feel better. But I appreciate you all for listening. I appreciate this time together. And I think, as Aaron just said, these are big issues today. The closing and potential closing of 12 two-year campuses across the state of Wisconsin. The shooting of a 16-year-old black kid by 84-year-old white dude through a locked door. Authoritarianism starting in Florida and spreading to places potentially like Wisconsin. And not taking care of our debt, our bills. Just saying, oh, it'll take care of itself. These are big things, you guys. They matter. And that's why we can't give up. That's why we can't just ignore it. We have to keep talking about it. We have to keep discussing. We have to keep listening to one another. And when we do that, we'll be a better community, a better state, a better country, and hopefully a better world. Your world will be better if you stick around. Kristen Bryan, Jay Matner are next with As Goes Wisconsin. Aaron and I will see you back here tomorrow. Trigvi Olson will be back with us tomorrow. Kira Sabin on Thursday. Until tomorrow, this is Todd Allbaugh on the Civic Media Radio Network, reminding each and every one of you, don't give up. Keep working. Keep banging on your drum. Keep banging on, and your day will